I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to have a look at equilateral triangles and some theorems in classical triangle geometry related to them. Here's a basic equilateral triangle, defined by the property that its three quadrants are equal. And I've called those three quadrants 4. That makes one of these segments equal to 1. And then in one of these triangles here, which is a right triangle, the three quadrants are 4, 3, and 1. That immediately implies that this spread here is opposite over hypotenuse. It's 3 quarters. That replaces 60 degrees. And this spread here is 1 over 4, replacing 30 degrees. So this is a very important triangle, replacing the 1, 2, root 3 triangle in ordinary classical trigonometry. Here I've shown you the same equilateral triangle with all three of its altitudes. The altitudes are also medians, they're also vertex bisectors. And I've rescaled things a little bit for a reason, so I've multiplied things so that this quadrant is now 12. So one of these half sizes, quadrant is 3. Then you see that in here, triangle formed by the center, the median, midpoint, and the vertex, we have a 1, 3, 4 triangle as before. That tells us that this ratio here to here is in terms of quadrants 1 to 4, in terms of distances 1 to 2. And it also tells us that in order to construct the center of an equilateral triangle, if we know one of the sides, we can take this vector v here and rotate it by 90 degrees or by a quarter turn, and then multiply it by 1 over root 3, because the ratio here to here is 3 to 1 in terms of quadrants, root 3 to 1 in terms of size. So there's a formula for this w here in terms of the vector v here, and it's, here's the formula for rotating by a quarter turn. We're going to have a look at how that applies to Napoleon's theorem. Napoleon's theorem is attributed to the French emperor. It says that if you have a triangle ABC, and you construct equilateral triangles on each of the three sides, then the three centers of those equilateral triangles, X, Y, and Z, always form an equilateral triangle themselves. The way we're going to prove it, I'm going to look at an example in F11. But what we're going to do is we're going to start with A, B, and C, and then I'm going to show you how to get these three points, X, Y, and Z, algebraically. So that algebraically we'll be able to check that this is an equilateral triangle by computing the quadrants between those three points. So I remind you how we're going to do that. So given A and C, we're going to use what we just did on the previous slide. We're going to first calculate that vector, then we're going to rotate it and divide by root 3 to get that vector W, and then we're going to combine the three things. In order to make that work, we need to have root 3 in the field, and I'm going to choose F11. In F11, the square root of 3 is 5. Because 5 squared is 25, which modulo 11, if you throw away 11s, you get 3. So 5 acts as root 3. And I'm going to choose 3 random points, A, B, C, those ones there. And then the vector joining A to C, if you divide that vector by 2, you get 1 over 2. Let me show you how to do that. So you take point C, subtract point A, you get the vector 2, 4. Half of it is 1, 2. Here's half of CB and half of BA you can calculate. Now to get this point Y, we need to take this 1 half of AC, add it to the point A, and there's A, there's AC 1 half, and then we have to rotate it and divide by square root of 3. Well, dividing by the square root of 3 is the same as multiplying by 1 over 5, which is 9 in F11. All right, so that's the operation that we're doing to get the point Y. And exactly the same way, you can get X, and you can get Z, and we get these three points as being the centers of the equilateral triangles built on this triangle here. And then you can check that in F11, the quadrants between any of two of these three points is exactly the same. Turns out to be 5. 8 minus 6 squared is 4, 0 minus 1 squared is 1, 4 plus 1 is 5. So the quadrants between any two of these points is 5. It really is an equilateral triangle. And this method of proof, since I've shown you exactly how to get X, Y, Z algebraically from A, B, C, actually generalizes to a proof of the general situation. You just do exactly the same thing with general or arbitrary points here instead of particular numbers. And you can check algebraically that in general, the triangle that you get will be equilateral. It's a proof of Napoleon's theorem over a general field. Now let's have a look at Morley's theorem, a 20th century discovery that's a little bit subtle. In fact, it's quite subtle, but it's very beautiful. You start with a triangle ABC, and you trisect each of the vertices. So from the vertex A, instead of splitting this vertex up into two by bisecting it, we split it up into three. These are called trisectors, those lines. And we do that at each of the three vertices, and we get a total of six trisectors. And then we see how these trisectors intersect. We take this trisector and intersect it with that trisector to get that point. These two trisectors there, and these two trisectors at that point there. And the statement is that the triangle that we get there by those intersections, DEF, is always equilateral, no matter what we started with. This is an interesting problem because it is hard to prove. Many people have struggled to prove this, and there are quite a few proofs around, but none of them, in my view, is really entirely convincing. Because what we would really like is a statement of the theorem and a proof of it that applies to general fields, that is universal. We don't have such a result yet. In fact, the difficulty is a little bit related to how we actually state the theorem, because we have to say something about which trisector here is being intersected with which trisector there. And in the absence of a picture, that's a little bit hard to do. Of course, this problem is also connected with the classical problem of antiquity of how to trisect an angle. It's been known for the last few hundred years that with ruler and compass, you can't trisect any arbitrary angle. In fact, you can't even trisect a 60-degree angle. There's no way of constructing by ruler and compass an angle of 20 degrees. Which only goes to show that talking about angles, 1 degree, 2 degree, 3 degree, is really a little bit waffly, since we don't know how to actually construct them. This problem of trisecting angles, or more generally dividing an angle up into 4 or 5 or 6, is a very subtle business, and is intimately connected with some polynomials we call spread polynomials. Next time I'm going to tell you or introduce you to the idea of spread polynomials, and they'll be beautiful orthogonal polynomials that I think you'll really like. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.